right, so now we're on to the B section. And what we're gonna see in the B section is a technique we've already used, modal interchange. And it relates to this A flat 7 chord right here in the second measure of the B section. All we're doing with this is we're modal interchange, like we said before. So instead of using the A flat 7 from the major key, we're gonna use from parallel minor. Not only that, we're gonna change its chord scale to half diminished. I'll tell you why in a second. All right, let's go to edit mode and plug it in. So now, so you hear the chord sounds the same, but what's really important is the scale that informs what's going on in that measure is completely changed. Now, this is a great technique to use when you're dealing with a dominant chord. Like we said before, in the first ending, you could always go with a mixo flat 9 or a mixo flat 9 flat 13 as a great substitution for a dominant chord. That doesn't necessarily work here. Well, the flat 9 would work, but the flat 9 flat 13 doesn't. And here's why. With our half diminished scale that we've created or gotten by changing the chord from A flat 7, by using the modal interchange, I should say, we've got this scale down here. It's just a combination of alternating whole steps and half steps. And it gives us a lot of tensions. It gives us a lot of alter tensions, but it also gives us a natural 13, which happens to be the third of our target. So whenever you're targeting a major chord, this is a great technique to use. And that's why I said earlier, you probably want to avoid the flat 9, flat 13, because the flat 13 would sort of undermine that foreshadowing you get when you leave, in this case, the F alone, instead of turning it into an F flat. So by leaving that F alone, you sort of set up the fact that you're going to this major D flat chord. You have all these other tensions too. So flat 9 would work, but the advantage to the half diminished scale is we get all these really cool tensions and all these other colors that we wouldn't have access to otherwise, unless we use this modal interchange and change the scale. So now what we're going to do is the second line of the B section, and there's a bunch of stuff going on here. First of all, we have this idea, and that's completely fine. That harmonic idea, it jives really well with the melody. And then we have this other idea over here, which is basically just a cut and paste of the first ending of the A section before we changed it. And it works just fine with what's going on within those two bars also. The problem is the connective tissue between these two ideas. This B flat 7 is 5 of 5 to the 2 of 2. It just doesn't work. Not to mention, it's not in the arrangement that we're analyzing right now. So not only is the real book sort of taking two disparate ideas and just kind of cramming them together because of some of the stuff that Garner does in a lot of his recordings. Crams a lot of music into a small space and plays a bunch of chords. And they were probably just like, oh, let's just tag on this ending that works really well on its own. Not only that, it jibes with the melody note. So here we go. But that doesn't necessarily work with what comes before. So what we're gonna do first is change the last two bars of the B section to just a 5 chord. And then we'll come back to it in a second, but let's just start with that in order to really kind of explain what's going on in the last two measures of our recording. We need to see this as just a 5 chord, just kind of like a static 5 chord. And now the idea before it sort of makes sense because we got a 5 of 5 to 5. All right, so now that we've got this 5 of 5 idea that makes sense, let's talk about what Garner does in the first two bars of this line here. And it's really quite simple. All he does is take this 2-5 of 3 and turn it into a 2-5 of 5, which we've already kind of established by doing this B flat 7 to E flat 7 that we just put there. So all I'm going to do is replace this G7 right here which you can see in the map is down in this region, as it is the 5 of 3. I'm going to replace that with F minor 7 over here. So there's our new 2-5 of 5. And all that happens in the previous measure is just the same exact thing. And the reason it works, well, he's just extending this idea of this tension for one more measure that builds up and resolves when you get to this 5 chord. But also it works because the melody notes, the G's and the F's and the B flats that you hear here are all inside of F Dorian and B flat Mixolydian, the scales that these chords are built upon. Da 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 dum, da 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 dee, da da dum. And there's our brief resolution before that goes back to A flat in the next section. Alright, so now that we're done with that harmonic reinterpretation of the melody in those first two bars of the line, let's double back to those E flats that we left here a while ago and use two more techniques, dominant alterations and sub fives. It's important to also be aware of what the right hand is doing, what Garner is doing with his right hand, that chromatic line, because I feel like it sort of informs this reharmonization that we're about to do. Or vice versa. Either way, the point is they're connected in one way or another. So we're going to start with this E flat 7 chord right here by just leaving it alone. And then we're going to use that dominant alteration technique that I just talked about a second ago by changing E flat 7 to E flat 7 flat 5 by way of this altered chord scale. All right, now we're going to change this to E flat 7 sus 4. And then over here is where we're going to use our sub 5. This is just merely, I'm replacing the 5 chord of this measure with its sub 5 because they share the same tritone, therefore they're sort of like interchangeable. So now what we've gotten here is this really cool chromatic line within this harmony that you're going to hear start on the 5th of the 5 chord, B flat, and you're going to hear it go down chromatically. Culminate on this G when I get to the sub 5. Ooh, da, dee, da, dee, da, bum, bum. And he doubles back to the A section right there. So that chromaticism that you just heard by way of this reharmonization is sort of paralleling that chromatic run that he has going on his right hand. So now the only other thing worth noting is this sub 5 here is also altered. So let's use that right there, boom. Because of what happens on the pickup notes in the melody, there's a use of a C in those pickup notes that double back to the A section. So the sub 5 with the altered scale is going to contain that C that you're going to hear in the pickup notes. And you can see that scale kind of illustrated right down here, all the notes in it clearly laid out for us. Alright, so now we're back in the A section and we're coming down to the home stretch, and there's only a couple more measures to speak of. One of them is the last measure of this line. We're going to use a technique here, and then in the last two measures of the song we'll talk about that. So here, like I just mentioned, what we're going to use is a passing diminished chord. We're going to interpolate on this beat right here, the fourth beat, a passing diminished chord that's going to help us go back to this A flat chord really nicely. Not that this G flat 7 by itself doesn't do that, but, well, let me just plug the chord in first and I'll show you what I'm talking about. We're going to use this G diminished 7 right here as a stepping stone to get back to that A flat right there. So what's happened here, or what Garner's done here, is, like I said, use this diminished chord as a passing chord to get back to the A flat to create a nice chromatic line in the bass, and also sort of ratchets up the tension from this dominant chord into something that gives you a bit more tension, this dominant chord, that resolves when you go back to the A flat. So this idea of interpolating or inserting a diminished chord right before its target is a great way to set up that target. All right, so now all we have left are these last two bars, and all we're gonna do here is something we've pretty much already done. We did this back in the second ending of the A section when we broke up the monotony of this A flat chord that wasn't going anywhere or doing anything, and we just kind of inserted this D flat chord. Well, we're gonna do that here too. So we're gonna use this sort of cadential reharmonization technique again, along with more modal interchange, or borrowing from minor. So we're basically gonna be culminating on an A flat six on the last measure. And what we're gonna do to break up that monotony, like I said, is insert right here A flat minor, but I want it to be an A flat minor seven, or rather Garner wanted it to be an A flat minor seven. So we have to change the chord scale to Dorian to get all the right notes, and then boom, there we go. So now we have this really cool cadential reharm by way of modal interchange, or like I said, borrowing from minor. All right, so there you have it. Erroll Garner's version of Misty as featured on his 1965 album with all the techniques used. Hope that was helpful. As usual, like, subscribe, and hit that notification bell so that you can be made aware of when we release our next episode. We're gonna leave you today with the version that we learned playing and synced with Mapping Tonal Harmony Pro. Enjoy.